Mr. Spigot, you are auditioning, are you not, for the part of Tarzan?
Right.
Now, Mr. Spigot, I couldn't help noticing... almost at once... that you are a one-legged person.
You noticed that?
I noticed that, Mr. Spigot, when you've been in the business as long as I have. Get to notice these little things almost instinctively.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Mr. Spigot, you, a one-legged man, are applying for the part of Tarzan.
Right again.
A role that is traditionally associated with a two-legged man. And yet you, a unidexter, are applying for the role.
Right.
A role for which two legs would seem to be the minimum requirement. Well, Mr. Spigot, need I point out to you where your deficiency lies as regards landing the role?
Yes, I think you ought to.
Need I say, with overmuch emphasis, that it is in the leg division that you are deficient.
The leg division?
The leg division, Mr. Spigot. You are deficient in it to the tune of one. Your right leg, I like. I like your right leg. It's a lovely leg for the role. A lovely leg for the role. I've got nothing against your right leg. The trouble is, neither of you.
Knowing what I knew about Dudley while I was appearing with him at the Fortune Theatre and in New York, and his extraordinary allure for enormous pneumatic ladies, it was quite clear from the way in which he was pursued by these ladies that he had a strange sort of fawn-like charm, an almost pagan, pan-like capacity to enchant ladies.
Beyond the Fringe ran altogether for with the original cast for 4 years, 2 years in London, 2 years on Broadway. And when we came back from America, it was still running in the West End, and I think it continued for another 2 years in New York without us. So it must have been quite good material.
By 64, the show had come to an end. The four of us had left it, and then we all went our separate ways. I went back to London and was about to go back to medicine. Alan began his career as a playwright. Peter Cook began to work with Dudley on the series that made them very famous, the Not Only But Also.
Excellent. In a few moments, the Houses of Parliament will be blown to smithereens.
You are brilliant.
You are an idiot, Kraut.
Yes, Master Braun.
Stand by.
I'd better go, Pop.
Why, son?
I'm playing his cotton-picking part as well.
Oh, and Johnny?
Yes, Pop?
Your strings are showing.
Well, I've been putting on a bit of weight recently.
Oh.
Well, the easy thing about Not Only But Also, certainly in the early days, we used to sit around and giggle a lot with a tape recorder, which is a nice way of working.
It was great, actually. And then we used to listen to it back, giggle even more, and say what we didn't like.
And you'd jot things down?
Jot things down, headings, books. Yes. Be a little bit pernickety, yes. But you were pernickety in your way by being at the typewriter and typing things. And I said, wait a minute, where's that come from? And it was a line you'd written for me or for you, generally for you, of course. And it was your way of controlling it. It was your way.
Well, we were both stubborn and equally revolting.
Have you been down the Rubens?
No.
You haven't seen the Rubens?
No.
Right over there.
Who's there?
Yes, lovely. That's all the fat ladies with nothing on. Great pink fat ladies.
Yeah.
Except for a tiny little wisp of gauze. Always lands on the appropriate place, if you know that.
Yeah.
Always the wind blows a little bit of gauze over you know where now.
Yeah.
See it down there, can't you?
Of course, you know, it must be a million to one chance, Pete, that the gauze, you know, lands in the right place at the right time when he's painting. I bet there's thousands of paintings that we're not allowed to see where the gauze hadn't landed in the right place. Yeah. You know, it's on your nose or something.
Yeah. Well, I suppose if the gauze landed on the wrong place, Dad, you know, landed on the nose or the elbow or somewhere unimportant, what Rubens did was put down his painting and went off to have lunch, probably.
Yeah, or have a good look. Yeah.
One of the two.
You used to have great glee in coming up with these totally mad concepts. I mean, the idea of these two Cockney blokes, I mean, just talking about, you know, these bloody film stars that kept on bothering them was sort of wonderful.
It puts you off, doesn't it? You have bloody Greta Garbo on the windowsill.
I was just about to drop off when suddenly tap, tap, tap at the bloody window pane. I looked out. You know who it was?
Who?
Bloody Greta Garbo. Bloody Greta Garbo. Stark naked. Save for a shorty nighty. She was hanging onto the windowsill. And I could see her knuckles all white. She's saying, Peter, Kunst neun in the Rhein, you know how these bloody Swedes go on. I said, get out of it, bloody Greta Garbo. She wouldn't go, I had to smash her down with a broomstick. Poke her off the windowsill, she fell down onto the pavement with a great crash.
She had a nightie on, is that all?
That's all she had on, Dad, just a...
See-through?
A see-through, shorty nightie.
Yeah,
nothing else, except for her dark glasses, of course.
Following the success of Not Any But Also, we both drifted into the twilight world of films.